It's been 6 long months since we've reviewed a movie together, so we've got a lot of catching up to do, which is why tonight we're going to be highlighting some of our favorite films from the summer of 2011. This is the season 3 premiere of Movie Night. Hello and welcome to the third season of Movie Night. My name is Jonathan Paula. In this, the first of a two-part episode, I'll be highlighting some of my favorite films from this past summer. Next week, I'll share some of my disappointments, and I'll also reveal your picks for the most popular summer movie. But first, let's start off tonight with Cowboys and Aliens. This Western sci-fi mashup directed by Jon Favreau was released nationwide on July 29th and ended up grossing just slightly more than its $163 million budget. Daniel Craig stars as an outlaw who wanders into the 1873 town of Absolution with substantial amnesia and a weird alien device strapped to his wrist. When the owners of his alien wrist gun show up to the small western town and start abducting the townsfolk for experimentation, the outlaw teams up with Harrison Ford, who plays the local wealthy cattle rancher, to track down these mysterious demons from the sky and find their missing friends and family. The first half of this film is a breath of fresh air, an exciting and captivating blend of Western elements mixed seamlessly with the sci-fi genre. Witnessing an alien attack from the perspective of characters who barely understand the concept of outer space is a novel concept, and one I wish was examined further. Instead, these ideas and themes are pushed aside to make room for loud and explosive action scenes later in the film. Visually speaking, Cowboys and Aliens is a true delight. The visual effects are imaginative, detailed, and thrilling. Cinematically, Favreau fills nearly every scene with beautiful landscape shots of the Old West, so picturesque you could stick them right on a postcard. Although the plot descends into a typical Hollywood action film in the third act, the plot is an original one, not a reboot, remake, or sequel. And given that it's able to quite aptly hold your attention, such a feat is very commendable, especially so considering the film had 5 separate screenwriters. There are familiar elements, of course. The lone outlaw who has to band together with his enemies so they can achieve a common goal, and the scenes inside the alien spaceship feel very similar to old Star Trek episodes. Rounding out the supporting cast is up-and-comer Olivia Wilde, who, despite being incredibly easy on the eyes, mostly just recites her dialogue with little personality, as if trying to get the project over with. Craig and Ford, on the other hand, have 2 huge personas that are almost too big to share the screen together, so it was a great treat to see them both wearing cowboy hats, riding horses, and shooting revolvers. But neither one gives a particularly impressive performance, but given the genre, Academy nominations aren't expected either. It's no secret that I'm a huge Harrison Ford fan, but I can't help but notice with his increasing age, he just seems to be getting angrier and angrier, reduced to a typecast that does nothing more than ask him to constantly scream at his co-stars. Being a silver screen legend though, he pulls off these screams very well, even if it did cause me to crack an unintended smile or two. If you're in the mood for a classic summer blockbuster with chase scenes, pretty ladies, cool special effects, and some awesome locations, Cowboys and Aliens doesn't disappoint. It's the definition of a classic popcorn movie. And when taken with a grain of salt, it's an immensely enjoyable motion picture. Cool concept, a fun adventure. Well, that's what I had to say about the film. Now let's see what you had to say in the YouTube comments. Back again for the 119th time, here's the Rate-O-Matic to show us how we both scored Cowboys and Aliens. A 7 and an 8. Favreau did a splendid job bringing together 2 great genres and 2 great leading men for a very cool summer movie. But sadly, it wasn't much more than that. I thought it was cool. Some of you enjoyed the Western sci-fi blend, while others got more enjoyment from the explosive action scenes. Your scores averaged to a great. Our next film tonight is also an original sci-fi movie about creatures from the unknown. Steven Spielberg's Super 8. Grossing over 5 times its $50 million budget, Super 8 is, at first glance, another alien invasion-style film. But at its heart, it's a gripping story about coming to terms with the past and growing up. Set in 1979, the story follows a local group of kids from Ohio who witness a terrifyingly epic train crash while filming a short movie on a Super 8 film camera.
Start filming, be extra loud when the train passes by. Here we go, and action! I love you so much!
Love you too.
Guys, watch out! Joe, what the hell are you? Ah! Oh my God! Run!
When something loud and powerful emerges from the wreck, none of the children have any idea what to do next. Director J.J. Abrams carefully captures the emotional dynamic between these youngsters, beautifully paying homage to the Spielberg classic from 1982, E.T., which similarly follows a group of young kids dealing with out-of-this-world responsibilities. In many ways, Super 8 feels like a gritty modern-day retelling of E.T. with nostalgic elements of the Goonies thrown in for good measure. And the film is all the better for it. The scenes containing only the children interacting and arguing with each other over what they should do about what they just saw are some of the best in the film. Child actors Joel Courtney, Elle Fanning, and Riley Griffin are positively remarkable in their leading roles, showcasing just the right amount of fidgety awkwardness, inappropriate swearing, and camaraderie for each other that'll instantly remind you of when you were 12. As a director, Abrams hasn't made a bad film yet, and this motion picture is no exception. Every shot is carefully framed and choreographed, but never so much though that it feels that way. The actors, their motivation, and actions all feel motivated and necessary. Of particular note is the fast-paced train crash that sets the film's plot into motion. The sound mix in this sequence alone is sure to get an Oscar nomination. While the government cover-up of this train crash and the kids' attempts to discover the truth are an interesting element to watch unfold over the course of the 112-minute narrative, the real treat here is watching Courtney and Fanning's characters slowly come to terms with their mutual conflicts in life. Both have lost their mothers, and both of their dads seem to hate each other, which makes you root for their pseudo-romance that much more. Inherently, much of the tension comes from not knowing what escaped from the train early in the film. So when such details are very specifically revealed in the third act, the movie unfortunately begins to lose a bit of its magic. That said, Super 8 is an imaginative and original story that has plenty of fascinating and exciting sci-fi action scenes worthy of any summer blockbuster. But it's the kids at the heart of the film that really make this stand out. An admirable throwback to the classic growing up adventures of the 80s, like Stand By Me or E.T. Make sure to stay tuned for the end credits, where the especially adorable student film within a film is shown in its 3-minute entirety. It's a can't-miss scene that really makes the film memorable. An engrossing sci-fi with nostalgic elements. Well, that's my review on Super 8. Now let's read some of yours from the YouTube comments. In comes the Rate-O-Matic to score Super 8. A double 9. This was a spectacular film and easily one of the best of 2011. The incredible performances by the very young cast are worth the price of admission alone. I thought it was awesome. You agreed with me, mentioning everything from the cool special effects to the great acting and action scenes. Switching gears, our final film tonight is the lighthearted romantic drama, Crazy Stupid Love. Refreshingly outside of his zany comedy comfort zone, Steve Carell headlines an all-star cast that includes Ryan Gosling, Emma Stone, Julianne Moore, Marissa Tomei, Kevin Bacon, and a 13-year-old named Jonah Bobo, who plays Steve Carell's love-struck son in a role that definitely gives his Super 8 counterparts a run for their money. Married young and for 2 decades, Carell is getting a divorce after his wife, played by Moore, cheats on him with Kevin Bacon. For once, it's a welcome change to not see the husband constantly being painted as the cheating lowlife in a movie relationship. But now that he's single, Carell turns to Gosling's character, a 20-something barfly pickup artist who attempts to teach the middle-aged man a thing or two about getting back into the dating scene.
I think that your friend Hannah is really sexy.
Oh my God. You did not just say that. How old are you?
What are you, a lawyer?
Don't you think you're a little old to be using cheesy pickup lines?
Objection. Leading the witness. Wow, Hannah, you're really wearing that dress. I think you're doing it a favor.
Oh, God.
That's a line. Me sitting over there for the past 2 hours not being able to take my eyes off of you is a fact.
There are some lighthearted laughs to be found here, which mostly come at the expense of our leading man, whom you can't help but feel pity for. Carell does a great job of leaving his typecast of awkward loser to play a friendly, caring human who has simply lost the will to love again. He occasionally slips into bouts of awkwardness as well, where we all know Carell superbly excels. His numerous dating efforts are chronicled in a brilliantly edited single-take Steadicam montage that floats around the bar with a different Steve Carell in every corner of the room, as Gosling watches his protege from afar. Gosling himself exudes so much sexy confidence here, men will want to hang out with him and women will want to sleep with him. It's no wonder everyone's upset he got snubbed for People's Sexiest Man Alive honor last week. Moore, though, is truly the standout performer here, beautifully playing opposite Carell in a crumbling relationship she is entirely to blame for, but one she still wishes can work out. The conflict of love, infidelity, and guilt comes through painfully well in her performance. The plot complicates itself tenfold in the final act when the love triangle becomes a trapezoid of nonsense, with a late plot twist resembling something from an episode of Seinfeld. Bizarre, surprising coincidences aside, the story somehow remains believable and moving. Directors Glenn Ficarra and John Waquad do an amazing job of keeping you cheering for all the characters to resolve their situations happily. This film is far from groundbreaking, being filled with plenty of romantic cliches, characters making grand speeches protesting their undying love for one another, But Crazy Stupid Love has some very tender moments in it that really separate it from the typical rom-com crap fest we're subject to every year. The protagonists feel like genuine, flawed human beings going through a very difficult time, and not cookie-cutter characters on the screen. The writing is sharp, funny, and most of all, moving. And again, it's worth pointing out that this film is not a sequel, remake, or reboot, but a truly original motion picture more people ought to be watching these days. At least we find ourselves paying more money to see The Final Destination 16 in a few years' time. Luckily for mankind, Crazy Stupid Love grossed 3 times its $45 million budget, so perhaps there's hope for us yet. Refreshingly fun and heartwarming drama. That was my review on Crazy Stupid Love. Now let's read a few of yours from the YouTube comments. In comes the Red-O-Matic for the third and final time tonight to rate Crazy Stupid Love. An 8 and a 7. This is a delightful film with plenty of nuanced characters and sharp writing for a change. I thought it was great. Not many of you had a chance to watch and review this film for our premiere episode, but those that did praised the acting and the writing. You thought it was cool. That's gonna do it for tonight's films, so now let's take a look at what's currently playing in theaters with some of your tweet critiques. Remember, if you're going to the movies this weekend, make sure to tweet about it using the JPMN hashtag to have it featured on an upcoming episode. Next week, I'll be tallying your votes and revealing your pick for the best movie of the summer of 2011. So make sure to click the link below and cast your vote now. I'll also be reviewing some more of my personal highlights and lowlights from this past summer. Once again, thank you for watching Movie Night. My name is Jonathan Paula, and I hope to see you right back here next Friday.